Good afternoon, everyone. You are most welcome to Aula Medica and the ceremony in memory of Hans Rosling. My name is Daniel Hilden. I'm a student here at KI. And before we begin, I will just go through with you a couple of short information points. In the event of an evacuation, you will hear a recorded voice alarm message. Follow the instructions and evacuate through the nearest exit marked with a green emergency exit sign. Fire wardens in yellow vests will direct you to the assembly point. Also, as you might have noticed, we have placed mentometers at your seats. Please leave them under your seats before you leave. Furthermore, I would like to take the opportunity to say a couple of words about what Hans meant to his students. I am, and probably many of you in the audience, a part of a generation of students that grew up with Hans as our teacher and role model. Constantly busy and on the move, our energetic and enthusiastic professor took the time to sit down with students and encourage us. He had a very rare way of making us feeling important and significant. Even though Hans used to say that he was not an optimist, he made us feel more hopeful about the world that sometimes could seem chaotic and dark. He taught us to always think before we act and to constantly reevaluate the world around us. Moreover, and perhaps more importantly, he taught us to speak the truth and to always act responsibly with compassion and kindness. Thanks to Hans, a whole generation of students across the globe have a fact-based worldview and the tools to change the world. We, his students, will stand in the front line, continuing his endeavor for the betterment of health for everyone, everywhere. And so with those words, I would now like to move on and introduce our master of ceremonies, a person who was a very close friend and colleague of Hans Rosling, professor and former vice chancellor of Karolinska Institutet, Hans Wigzell.
Well, Hans was a remarkable guy. I mean, he really was. Completely unexpected. He came from a family who had no academic background. He was born in a place in July in 48. He was 68. In academic hospital in Uppsala, and he never left Uppsala, despite the fact that he was a globetrotter. How was he as a child? Well, he was seemingly extremely curious, dangerous. He ventured into sort of almost lethal situations. He came into the school, and he sort of... what is this? I have no pointer. Yes, I have. Good. So he went into the school, and he was a storyteller, immediately a storyteller. He was running around. When they got marks, he got lowered marks in conduct and order, upfront ordning. He was actually very bad in writing and spelling and was almost suffering until a very intelligent teacher found out that he was dyslexic. He was a fantastic memory. He learned the whole Hamlet dialogue by himself, wanted to be an actor, was thrown out immediately from the school theater because he couldn't act. He was only playing himself. He was a stage master of a kind of game. So he was unusual. And with regard to this sort of, well, we should get back like this. Well, this is the first. Yes, yes. Look, this is the first picture of Hans. I looked at pictures of Hans and he always standing at the side. He never in the middle. He was always standing outside, sort of the rhyme. This is the guy now, 30 years old, who convinced the school, the major school, to have a whole day devoted to United Nations. I said, absolutely remarkable being such a guy. He loved mathematics, statistics, and the teacher told him about that once, let's say, in every class there should be a married couple. Here they are, Agneta and Hans. They went into school together for 6 years. Hans didn't really, I mean, he thought she was nice, I think, but when she started to beat him in mathematics, she became beautiful. they became a couple, and actually stayed on forever. Okay, so then they left. Hans studied statistics first, and then medicine. Agneta was ahead of him, started medicine, and then in 1967, when he was an international student, something happened to Hans, which actually. It was a crucial meaning determining the first period in his life that took place in 1967.
På hösten 1967, då var jag med och arrangerade mötet i Uppsala för Eduardo Modlane, den första ledaren för Mosambiks befrielsefront. Och Eduardo Modlane, det var en vis och klok professor från Michigan i sociologi, Nelson Mandela typ. Jag tror det var bara 8 stycken som kom till det där mötet. Och efteråt så frågade han var en av oss, vad läser du, när blir du klar? Och då kom jag ihåg, jag sa, och jag ska börja läkarutbildningen, när blir du klar? 1975. Då är vi nog självständiga, sa han. Kom och jobba hos oss då. Och så tog jag honom i hand på det. Och sen dödades han av en brevbomb året efter. Och det där gjorde ju att det där löftet blev lite allvarligare. Va? Och sen 1975 då var jag färdig läkare och Mosambik blev självständigt. Och då var jag med och bildade Afrikagruppernas rekryteringsorganisation. Och så åkte vi iväg. Agneta var barnmorska då och jag var läkare. Så åkte vi ner och jobbade i Mosambik.
Hans kept his promise always. So here they are, the family and a friend, another doctor. And it's Anna, who's now is... a sort of international renowned mycologist, and Ola, who would you will see later, who is acting the director of Gapmanderen Foundation. Agneta's a midwife, Hans is a doctor. And what kind of sort of situation did they enter? It was one of the poorest countries in the world. Sweden was one of the richest at that time. Here is, let's say, the crowd. You can see again, Hans is on the side of the photo. People in the white dress, they have been kind of educated. The one in the dark ones were not. The district, population-wise, like Malmö, sometimes Hans was the only doctor in Malmö, although it was then spread out in a gigantic district. Scarce material, you had to do everything. Surgery, fractures, deliveries, whatever. And actually, it was a kind of routine work, and the contact with the patient was extremely important. And Hans was pretty good at that, and so was Agneta. But however, in 1981, when he was a physician, something happened again which changed his world.
Här är cancerpatienterna. Det här är cancerpatienterna. Det här är från 21 augusti 1981.
Det är ett datum som sitter inbränt i Hans Roslings minne. Det var den dagen bönen om hjälp kom på baksidan av en gammal biobiljett från en by långt ute på landsbygden.
Hälsopost kallas det. Distriktssköterskemottagning skulle vi säga på svenska. Den italienska nunnan jobbade. Hon hade skrivit brevet. Kom hit på en gång. Jag har 30 förlamade kvinnor och barn som har bägge benen förlamade på ett sätt jag aldrig har sett förut. Och när jag kom dit så fattade jag att hon hade jobbat i 20 år där. Och det här var det första som hade uppträtt. Och då när jag undersökte den första kvinnan här, alltså, hon hade väldigt kraftiga reflexer då. Och det är alltså en spastisk förlamning, tvärtom mot vad polio är. Va? Det är ungefär som MS, fast det hade kommit på en enda dag. Och så 30 stycken lika. Va? Det tog mig mindre än en minut att förstå att det här är någonting jag aldrig har hört talas om förut. Och så hade jag neurologiska boken med mig och så läste. Va? Det fanns en sjukdom bara som var beskriven från Indien då, eller Bangladesh. Va? Men det fanns inte, och då insåg jag att här kanske jag står inför en ny sjukdom. Och man blev så rädd, alltså. Man blev så in i Norden rädd. Därför det första som man tänker på en gång, det är jag kommer att bli smittad. Och man blir så feg och ynklig. Va? Man börjar på en gång försöka undersöka sjuka människor. Så börjar tänka man på sig själv liksom, så här, och backar ur. Va? Man behöver tvungen att andas djupt liksom, och tänka efter och tvätta händer och bestämma. Nej, det här är min uppgift. Jag måste ta hand om det här. Jag måste undersöka det här.
It wasn't an infectious disease. Hans studied, I mean, became a scientist, felt it was his duty to go and work. But he worked on this for, in essence, some 20 years. It was linked to the sort of cassava, the diet, the starvation, the poor eating it fast. And he became an epidemiologist. He went back to Uppsala. Here you see him here like that. Where he graduated in 86, became a sort of assistant professor somewhat later. And in the family, they got a third child, Magnus, sitting here, who's now a doctor at the academic hospital. So then started a stream of sort of scientific doctoral theses. His first one, Hans himself. Then came sort of cyanide. There was a poison in this thing. The reason for getting this conso thing was linked to the cassava, the eating, the poisonous thing killing the upper motor neurons. And it continued like this for several times. And then, this is in 1997, there came this special thesis from Jean-Pierre Banea Mayambu. So please come up. And Jean just came here, let's say, flying in from Kinshasa this morning. Was a PhD student of Hans from 1990 to 1997. Worked with Hans until the end of his death, just a couple of weeks before, to find the last clues of how conso was caused by eating cassava. And today, Dr. Banea Mayambu is director of the National Nutrition Program in Congo. So please welcome.
Thank you, Chairman. So, in a church event, I represent here the Ministry of Health and Pronanit, which is a national nutrition program in DRC. I tell you that I miss words to say in this painful separation. I only want to thank Hans for all he did for our country, DRC, and for Africa. It is Hans who discovered the paralysis disease conso as a distinct disease different with poliomyelitis. This had permitted WHO to set up strategies to avoid confusion in the treatment of the two diseases. The affected conso people, especially women and children, were abandoned by our society, thinking that conso was a result of sorcery. But Hans approached them, he paid the scholar fees for children, he paid crutches and clothes for the women, and today some of conso children are educated and are working, and women are married. This would not be possible without Hans' interventions. Conso is linked to cassava, our main staple food. By his engagement to elimination of that crippling disease, he did high contribution to not only the improvement of children and women's life conditions, but also the improvement of a daily diet for the whole people, the people eating cassava, especially in DRC. We are very proud for the high education we got from him. I remember always with a smile in lips, he taught us how to live in the villages with the poorest of the poor to understand their problem. We together descended and mounted long mountain with large basket of cassava in our back to understand what women were facing every day as workload. In Paikongila, with Torki Tulesha, who is not here, during 3 weeks, we slept in a so-called house that was made only with sticks and leaves, without windows, with a lot of mosquitoes in the daily and as well as the night. And in each morning, we used to cross with a small pirogue, a dangerous river with snakes and the crocodile to see conso cases. Really, I can't enumerate what us did for our country and for Africa. And I ask his memory to accept our gratitude to all it did as contribution to the health and development, not only for DRC, but also for all the countries eating cassava as their main food, and also for especially Kwanzaa-affected women and children. His memory will always remain alive in our countries. Thank you, Hans. Thank you for all you did for our countries.
Thank you.
So, Hans was recruited to Karolinska Institutet in 1997. I became a professor in international health in 99. We made some short movies at Karolinska at that time when they installed at Gröna Lund at this time, an entertainment part in Stockholm.
Min framtidsvision som forskare inom internationell hälsa är att få medverka till utveckling av ett forskningssamarbete kring hälsoproblem i de fattiga länderna som är av hög vetenskaplig kvalitet och som i framtiden gör att forskningsresultaten styr inriktningen på bistånd och inte som det nu tycks vara tillfälliga nycker i biståndspolitiken som styr inriktningen på forskningssamarbetet.
So what you see here is actually now Hans sort of moving to take a third position. He is actually continuing to do research for many years, delivering a series of articles or doctoral theses. But he's moving now to also become a global teacher. So this will continue in parallel for some time. It's interesting that when he starts to become a global teacher, he's comparatively old. He's around 50 years of age when he actually breaks through. But he continued with this thing, doing a scientist, and in his efforts to do this, things are breaking up. So the next speaker is Johan von Schreeb, who was the last graduate student of Hans, and also realized that this was in a changing world. Johan and Hans knew each other for a long time, many, many years, starting with discussion about, please come up, starting with a sort of discussing, should one create a sort of Doctors Without Frontiers in Sweden, and so on. Johan is known as, popular as the Doctor Disaster, Doctor Katastrof in Sweden, right? He thrives in catastrophes, okay? But he has actually, the last one was, where he was actually partly involved with Hans, was in Sierra Leone in 2014, with regard to the Ebola, okay? So please, Hans, well, please, Johan, how was Hans?
One does not note that time actually passes until it stops. Hans' time stopped 6 months short of the average life, global life expectancy of 69 years. Development, Hans said, is the shift from the burial of children to the burial of the elderly. It is normal in life to have to bury your parents, but it can never be normal to have to bury your children. Development is what makes this shift happen. Poverty is the opposite of development. It locks people in misery. Hans fought poverty throughout his life. If he did take order, and this is really a question mark whether Hans took orders from someone, it was from the poor lady that was gently stirring her cassava porridge on the open fire. She was his mentor. Hans said, poor people are not stupid. If they were stupid, they would be dead. As his last PhD student, I occasionally got a few minutes of supervision while he was traveling the world, meeting Bill Gates, etc. And during these meetings, suddenly Hans' eyes focused as two laser beams. And he started looking on my manuscript, and then his ink pen in hand made drastic changes to the manuscript, changes that took me months to try to address. And after I finished my PhD, which I actually did, Hans gave me custody of our common baby, which is the Center of Research on Healthcare in Disaster, which is in the next building here at Karolinska. But he remained available when needed. In 2014, I was working in Sierra Leone for WHO, trying to fight Ebola. And due to that, the epidemic was out of control, I called Hans and said, please, come and help. And it didn't take him many days to understand that the situation actually was out of control. And consequently, and Hans was very consequent, he cancelled all lectures and everything planned for the next 3 months, and he left for Liberia to assist the Minister of Health to try to map the situation and be the assistant epidemiologist of Liberia. And what is well worth noting, he was not being paid by any organization, but actually working for Karolinska Institute. So I turned out to be his boss, since the payment came through our center. And I'll tell you, it was not easier to be his boss than to be his PhD, PhD student. My first publication came out of an assessment I did following the 2004 terrorist attack on the Beslan school in North Ossetia in Russia, which you might remember because it was a very horrible attack that killed hundreds of children and injured also hundreds of school children. And the Swedish government was asked to assist. And the government asked Hans and I, so what should Sweden assist with? Instead of coming with suggestions, we decided that I should go there to on-site look on the situation and decide on the needs. So I rapidly traveled to Beslan and could quickly document that there was no need for outside medical assistance. There were hundreds of skilled Russian surgeons and doctors to cater for those injured. So could Sweden contribute to reducing the suffering of the school children in Beslan? Hans knew that Astrid Lindgren's books were very popular in Russia. But the book Bröderna Lejonhjärta, or Brother Lionheart, was not available in the Ossetian language, which was spoken in Beslan. This book tells the story of how the older brother, Jonathan, provides comfort to his young brother, Skorpan, who is dying from tuberculosis. Jonathan tells Skorpan not to fear death. When we die, Jonathan explains, we will travel to Nangiala, which is a paradise where we will all reunite and meet again. This book puts words on the pain of loss, but also the fight between evil and good. It provides relief. Our proposal for Swedish support to Beslan was to translate Brother Lionheart to Ossetian. However, our advice was not followed, but it taught me to think outside the box. Now Hans has traveled to Nangiala, and before we travel there to meet him, we must work harder to reduce poverty. This is more important today than ever, as even the virtue behind fighting poverty is being challenged. We owe this work of fighting poverty to Hans, but more importantly, to the lady in front of the fire. Thank you.
Thank you.
So as was alluded to, Hans was moving away from research. This was his last graduate student. And he was particularly intrigued, let's say, by the preconceived, let's call it prejudice or feelings of people about it. So he wanted actually to engage the public. And in that he developed, let's say, a very challenging way of communicating in a one dimension, statistically with the people. We, of course, know that you are extremely selected to come here, as I can see, being very good, hopefully, in knowing what's going on. So in doing this, first with this sort of asking question and handing up, now doing with the Mentimeter, I would ask Helena Nordenstedt, assistant professor at Karolinska, to come up and, let's say, test you, I mean, check you. Are you really as good as you think you are? Okay. Please, Helena.
Thank you. We are quite many in here today who have had the chance to work with Hans, many from Karolinska, especially from his Department of Public Health Sciences. We have worked with him in research, we have worked with him in education, some for decades, and some like me only the last few years. And what we do all have in common, I think, is now the feeling of responsibility to carry this on, either in research. Like next year, we're arranging a global health research conference here at Karolinska, or in education. And when it comes to education, education in global health has never been as thriving at Karolinska as it is right now, which is a lot thanks to Hans. Right now, there is an internationalization process going on, and global health is to be added to all programs at Karolinska. Isn't that fantastic? We aren't there yet, so you can save the applause for later, but we're working on it. I have worked with global health education in the past 4 years. Together with Anna-Mia Ekström, I am responsible for the undergraduate course in global health, where we send about 200 students each year to a low-income country. And we send them to countries like Vietnam, to Uganda, Tanzania, and Laos. And in these countries, the students get to spend a night in the countryside, in a poor family, to understand, to see with their own eyes what poverty is. And guess whose idea that was from the beginning? So this is the same course that Hans started 20 years ago, and where he really wanted to make the students see what it is like to live in poverty and to understand why people in some countries have better health than in some other countries, what determines health around the world. And this is also the course where Hans started with his so-called chimpanzee test, where he tested medical students. And I think he was so surprised by seeing that the medical students apparently knew less about global facts about global development, than chimpanzees would have known on random. And then, after he tested the students, he went on to test the KI staff and the professors. And to his horror, he realized that they also did not know more than chimpanzees. They were better than the students, but not better than the chimpanzees. And I think this moment when Hans realized this is what really triggered him, what fueled him on his quest to teach these basic global facts, not only to students and staff at Karolinska, but to the whole world. That's a big audience. But if someone was to succeed, it was Hans. And if it was something about him, I did talk about before that we all felt the responsibility to continue and to carry on his work. And if it's something that I have decided that I want to carry on, it is the opportunity to take the opportunity to always teach, which we are to do today, which I get to do with the Global Health students, which I get to do when I have lectures with Gapminder. Today, we are to use the Mentimeters. So please if you can find these little white devices, you can see that there's a 1, 2, and 3, or an ABC. And there will be 3 questions with an A, B, and C answer for you. And don't worry, as Hans said, we don't collect DNA on them yet, so you are anonymous for now. Maybe in the future we can collect DNA backwards. Let's see. But we won't do it today, at least. So it's time for the so-called chimpanzee test, which switched name to the Hans Global Facts Quiz. And now it's the Gapminder questions. The first question: what is the life expectancy of the world population? Is it 50, 60, or 70 years? A, B, or C? Let's see. And if you think you got it wrong the first time, you can, the device will only save your last answer, so you can redo it. A, B, or C? You'll have 4 more seconds. Okay, let's see. Question number 2. How many of the world's one-year-old children have been vaccinated against measles? Is it 20%, 50%, or 80%? I think you're getting faster. You can see the responses are really running very fast. There are a few last hesitant ones. Come on. Good. And we close. Last question. How many children will there be in the world in the year 2100, according to the United Nations? Today we have 2 billion, as you can see. But will there be A, 4 billion, B, 3 billion, or C, 2 billion? 4 billion, 3 billion, or 2 billion? Hey, you're definitely learning. This is the fastest one so far. Very good, and we close. So are you curious about your results? I'm going to be quite mean to you. I'm going to compare you to the Swedish public. And not only am I going to compare you to the Swedish public, I'm also going to compare you to the Norwegian public. And meanest of all, I'm going to compare you to the results of all the Karolinska students and staff tests in the past 5 years. What do you think about that? So let's see. You do know what the right answer is, do you? Let's see how the Swedish population answered. If the Swedish population is correct, the right answer would be 60 years. Let me tell you something, they are not. Let's see if the Norwegians are any better. No, looks the same. And what about the KI students and staff? Quite similar, it seems like. And time to see you. Wow. We have a correct answer, and you provided the correct answer. Fantastic. Let's go to the second question. Let's see the Swedish public to see. You just can see what did the Swedish public not answer, and you know what the right answer is. Let's see the Norwegians. They are always a tiny little bit better than we are. And this is where Hans would say, we can also see the Americans. The Swedes are not doing very well compared to the Norwegians and Americans. But Hans would always say, and who is the professor of international health in this country, in Sweden? So he was not very pleased with this. But let's see what the KI student and staff said. Here, apparently, he did have some effect. People were listening to the measles question. And what about you? Pretty good. So now you know what the right answer is, right? You're doing better than the Karolinska students. Fantastic. Last one. How many children will there be in the world? There are 2 billion today. Will there be 2, 3, or 4 billion in the year 2100? Swedish public? Okay, now you have the right answer. Yeah, you still have the right answer. We beat the Norwegians. And we beat the Americans for the first time. The only question. And here, the KI students and staff are actually better than random, better than the chimpanzees, but not much. What about you? Ah, better than the random, but you can have a small applause still, I think. So, I think Hans would have been pleased to see today that he did have an effect on all the people who were close to him. And we did listen to him. And if you feel that you did not listen to him enough, you just go to the Gapminder website and see all the documentaries and the videos again. They are there, and you can see them many times. So, thank you very much. And an applause to you. You did very well.
Thank you very much. Science was still going on in Port Hans. I mean, he had all the graduate students. He was working a lot with the sort of the various kind of research activities, Karolinska in Africa. And the major provider for support was, of course, SIDA, the Swedish International Development Agency. So I called upon Hanna Akuffo, who was, let's say, a major sort of component or discussing partner in that one. This was a long, positive collaboration, sometimes with quite interesting twists. And Hanna played an important role since this, and she's now also professor at parasitology here at KI. Please, Hanna.
Thank you. Hans and I started together, working together in 1997 at Karolinska Institutet research training program called KIRT. This was aimed at research training of students from Central American countries and Ethiopia. With Hans as the chairperson of the KIRT committee and me as the KIRT manager, two very different people. Hans, a man who made spontaneous statements, me more cautious, stating what we had previously agreed upon together, rather than go for a eureka moment that comes to mind during the meeting. I found Hans a bit too cocky for my taste at the time. This combination did not bode well for a good working relationship, I thought. However, on our first duty travel together to Costa Rica, I put my frustrations of how I found his inability to keep to an agreed joint point of view on the table. He said to me, "I have so many medical conditions that can end my life prematurely. I thus do not have time to waste trying to follow courtesies when a new spontaneous idea comes to me, which seems to be good to me for me." Somehow, my acceptance and understanding of this point of view led us to an open working relationship filled with many arguments, but which resulted in strong mutual respect and trusting fellowship. I characterize our relationship as Hans accelerating through life in a shiny Ferrari, and I moving forward in my reliable Volkswagen. I moved to the Swedish International Development Agency, SIDA, where I had the privilege to be in charge of developing a new research cooperation program with Uganda. Makerere, identified as the focus university for SIDA support, was a university with tradition of research, but which had fallen into disrepair. The decision was thus to support Makerere University's own PhD training rather than degrees from Swedish universities. This posed a challenge for the potential Swedish partner universities, including Karolinska Institutet. There was intense pressure on me to change this idea. However, I did not budge, believing that the time was ripe for a paradigm shift. In typical Hans style, he investigated the legal possibilities of a joint degree between Makerere and Karolinska Institutet, and together with Rector Hans Wigzell, was able to find a way to allow joint degrees, now called double degrees, between Makerere Faculty of Medicine and KI. A truly historic achievement initiated by KI. This cooperation has been very productive and has resulted in many highly relevant degrees by Ugandan and Swedish research students. And I think many of you have been part of this collaboration. Most of the other Swedish universities involved had said such a solution was impossible. KI, through Hans, looked for evidence that it was possible and went on to make it possible. Over the years, Hans did not let me forget that the Department of Research Cooperation, CEDA SAREC, rejected his proposal for financial support for the proof of concept of the idea that came to be known as Gapminder. It did not matter how many times I reminded him that despite this rejection, another department of CEDA did understand the idea and had the possibility to provide some of the needed seed funding. Despite this collective condemnation of the erring of a CEDA department, Hans was a very regular visitor to CEDA, where he came as a requested and trusted speaker at different types of meetings, including providing evidence of the ways that the indicators of health show that conditions have continued slowly to improve for many people living in areas previously known to have unacceptable levels of infant and maternal mortality, amongst other indicators. Hans understood that I am hesitant to being in the limelight. And in different ways, he found ways to push me to get out of my comfort zone, such as standing on this stage to question Bill Gates, or I suspect putting my name out there to push me into the Swedish public arena on TV and on radio. I can only say thank you, Hans, for the trust and for helping me get out of my comfort zone in order to express things of importance. Knowing you has meant a lot to me. You knew me and my conviction that many good things that have happened to me are all by the grace of God. I thus thank God for that wonderful grace that I was given to have you as my colleague and my friend. Thank you for the dignity that you and your work brought to a lot of people in this world. May your soul rest in peace.
Thank you, Hanna. Hans improved as a teacher, and he realized also the core issue of pedagogics. It is to induce excitement. And education occurring according to the time-wise, the element of excitement will stay on. Okay. So I'm very happy to now invite Anna Maria Lundberg. Anna Marianne Lundberg to come up here to the scene. Anna Marianne is here as a representative from the International Professional Organization, SSAI. Please.
Thank you. Now, it's always a little bit difficult to be a speaker when there are many speakers because the subject runs out. So I'm very lucky today that we're talking about Hans, because I think that even if we had several weeks to talk about Hans, or months or years, we would never run out of anything to say, because Hans really always had something to say. When I joined SSAI, Hans had already been a member for a long time, and over about a year, he became my mentor. Now, SSA has a very long tradition, and in many ways, it's quite a strict world, so we often assume that we knew everything, how it had been, and what it was always going to be. So Hans would show up and prove us wrong. That's what he always did. He proved us wrong. He always made sure that we knew that you cannot speak unless you have all the facts, and you cannot judge a book merely by its cover. And that's incredibly important, that things are not always what they seem to be. Because what we think the world is determines also what we think is possible. And it's because of the little things we do every day that we shape the world. Now, when I became a teacher at DOC, Hans showed me that it's just not enough to know the fact either. No, you have to show people and make sure people truly understand. And I would actually like to show you, for you who are not familiar with SSAI, what we actually do. If I can get a little bit of assistance. Thank you. Now, SSAI is actually the International Organization of Sword Swallowers. Yes, that's true. And a few years ago, Hans was introduced to our Hall of Fame. And he did always say, he said many things. And one of the two things he always said, whenever you were to swallow swords, is that you needed two things. And the first thing was you needed to always dress for the part. And of course, the second thing Han told me many, many times, until I got tired of it and finally did it, is that you need a drum. Can I have a little drums? Thank you. And then you can make the seemingly impossible possible.
How did you meet?
Well, actually, I was working in America, and I was going to Sweden, and I needed to get some help with one of my swords to get the metal fixed. So I thought, there must be someone there that knows about that. So I went on our association website, and I looked, and I sent a message. And then Hans popped up and said, hello, I swallow swords. And I was like, really? You do? It's not what you expect in our world, actually. He's more unusual. The thing is, in the beginning, I was shocked that he was a professor. And now I'm more shocked after getting to know him and his family that Hans, in fact, was a professor at all, not just a circus artist, because that was very
awesome. And you can see the statistics behind him. That links excitement and memory.
Yes, thank you very much.
Jag tar den. Tack. Jättebra.
So you could see the extreme happiness actually. If you see the video, Hans is so happy when he's doing that. 2007. When it actually sort of made the hallmarks of his. So, but then he combined all this. The statistics, I could comment upon that, the technology, his presentation and the like. And in 2010, he made one of the most successful presentations made for BBC, has been seen at something like 8 million people. It's a beautiful example of presentation of talent, pedagogic proficiency, and above all, a unique way of using huge statistical materials. Let's look at the video.
Visualization is right at the heart of my own work too. I teach global health. And I know having the data is not enough. I have to show it in ways people both enjoy and understand. Now, I'm going to try something I've never done before. Animating the data in real space, with a bit of technical assistance from the crew. So, here we go. First, an axis for health. Life expectancy, from 25 years to 75 years. And down here, an axis for wealth. Income per person, $400, $4,000, and $40,000. So down here is poor and sick, and up here is rich and healthy. Now, I'm going to show you the world 200 years ago, in 1810. Here come all the countries. Europe brown, Asia red, Middle East green, Africa south of Sahara blue, and the Americas yellow. And the size of the country bubble showed the size of the population. And in 1810, it was pretty crowded down there, wasn't it? All countries were sick and poor. Life expectancy were below 40 in all countries. And only UK and the Netherlands were slightly better off, but not much. And now, why start the world? The Industrial Revolution makes countries in Europe and elsewhere move away from the rest. But the colonized countries in Asia and Africa, they are stuck down there. And eventually, the Western countries get healthier and healthier. And now, we slow down to show the impact of the First World War and the Spanish flu epidemic. What a catastrophe! And now I speed up through the 1920s and the 1930s. And in spite of the Great Depression, Western countries forge on towards greater wealth and health. Japan and some others try to follow, but most countries stay down here. Now, after the tragedies of the Second World War, we stop a bit to look at the world in 1948. 1948 was a great year. The war was over, Sweden topped the medal table at the Winter Olympics, and I was born. But the differences between the countries of the world was wider than ever. United States was in the front, Japan was catching up, Brazil was way behind, Iran was getting a little richer from oil, but still had short lives. And the Asian giants, China, India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, and Indonesia, they were still poor and sick down here. But look what is about to happen. Here we go again. In my lifetime, former colonies gained independence, and then finally they started to get healthier and healthier and healthier. And in the 1970s, then countries in Asia and Latin America started to catch up with the Western countries. They became the emerging economies. Some in Africa follows. Some Africans were stuck in civil war and others hit by HIV. And now we can see the world today in the most up-to-date statistics. Most people today live in the middle, but there are huge differences at the same time between the best of countries and the worst of countries. And there are also huge inequalities within countries. These bubbles show country averages, but I can split them. Take China, I can split it into provinces. There goes Shanghai. It has the same wealth and health as Italy today. And there is the poor inland province Guizhou. It is like Pakistan. And if I split it further, the rural parts are like Ghana in Africa. And yet, despite the enormous disparities today, we have seen 200 years of remarkable progress. That huge historical gap between the West and the rest is now closing. We have become an entirely new converging world. And I see a clear trend into the future. With aid, trade, green technology and peace, it's fully possible that everyone can make it to the healthy, wealthy corner. Well, what you have seen in the last few minutes is a story of 200 countries shown over 200 years and beyond. It involved plotting of 120,000 numbers. Pretty neat, huh?
Yes, pretty neat, but a hell of a lot of work behind it. Really. One of the things that Hans actually did was to get the statistics, the statistic material. He worked for several years to get them released from the World Bank and other sort of public things, because they were not publicly accessible. He cajoled and trickled them and the like. In 2010, the World Bank sort of capitulated and wrote a letter actually also to Nier and say, we give it all out. Hans, you've done a beautiful work. In 1999, Ola, the son, Anna, daughter, stepdaughter, three other guys started to work with the statistics, making the bubbles and the like. When Hans made his sword fighting, the sword swallowing and the like, and the year before also, the Google people were extremely sort of attracted by that, okay? And they wanted to get them over, buy them. So we made a deal, I was involved in that in part, where we just sort of, the gap mind, the little groups, go in the bubbles, and Hans were sold, quotation mark, to Google for a couple of million dollars to provide a foundation. Hans was very proud being sold like a professional, high-paid football player. Okay, he was very happy about that. They came back, and they continued to work on this. And developed, let's say, in this situation, what actually became then Gapminder Foundation, if you look on it. At the same time, to provide money for this, Hans went on continuous lecture tours. He'd give lectures, about 100 lectures a year. And if he went, let's say, to sort of big companies, it took a substantial fee to educate them, and the money went to the Gapminder Foundation. There was no public money to support this because it was outside the box, this kind of thing. But one person, the first person that came, Sven Hagströmer, please come up, was actually Sven here, who actually sort of came and then started to support Gapminder Foundation from very early days. So I would like to hear from Sven, why did you do it? Please.
Thank you, Hans. It is July 25th, 2005, just before 1 p.m. My family and I are sailing in the Finnish archipelago. The Scandinavian summer is at its very best, but something completely different has caught our interest. We are eagerly waiting for the summer program from the Swedish public radio to start. A professor from the Karolinska Institutet, Hans Rosling, unknown to us, will be the host today. He has introduced himself earlier, I quote, "I will talk about devotion for nuns, pilots, and African peasants, the joy from children, circus, data games, and globalization, and how difficult it is to negotiate with Fidel Castro as well as the Swedish Department of Education," unquote. Well, certainly an interesting mix of topics. The radio program became the defining moment for me and my family. Hans made a seemingly contradictory combination of topics to a perfect whole. We had found an extremely inspirational role model in Hans. His message went directly out from the loudspeakers into our hearts. We even listened to the replay later that evening with the same enthusiasm. So, when Hans founded Gapminder, it was an easy decision to become a sponsor of the following task, quote, "Instead of wasting our time blaming the media or condemning the human brain, Gapminder develops free teaching material to dismantle misconceptions and promote a fact-based worldview," unquote. Well, in today's language, it could be expressed as facts, real facts, instead of alternative facts. But can one man really change the world? Hans, you were not a conventional speaker. You were an extraordinary communicator, hence your success. Your Swinglish, your hoarse voice, and the long conventional pointer were all effective tools to get your message through into our minds. As we all now know, Swinglish and undisputable facts together with extreme energy can really change the world, or at least make it more understandable. Of course, we are very much aware that we don't have your gifts, perhaps the Swinglish, as you hear. But we all engage ourselves to forward these undisputable facts about our planet to our families, to our enterprises, to our networks, and to our communities, the way you did and Gapminder does. I'm convinced we can contribute to a better and more enlightened world. Let this become an act of remembrance of what you have given to us. You convinced us that data set can change mindsets. So why not start today by letting the data set change the mindset of this 2-century-old institution, Karolinska Institutet? And don't forget, if words are not your favorite communication tool, there is always a Lego bricks solution for you. So from here on, let the revolution continue all over the world with Gapminder in the pole position. Thank you, Hans, for being a fantastic role model for all of us. You have done the complicated simple. You have broken down the barriers between the layman and the specialist. You saw the light where others saw problems and darkness. You gave us hope, but your cancer defeated hope. Thank you, Hans, for the time you let me into your brain and mind. You infected me and everybody here today with your curiosity, enthusiasm, and energy without limits. Thank you, Hans.
Thank you, Sven, for a very nice answer on my question. Gapminder Foundation is the next point on the program. So please come up, Ola and Anna. The Gapminder Foundation is actually the creation that sort of created all this kind of information. It's also the situation, let's say, doing something that can maintain and put forward the sort of the mission and visions of Hans Rosling. And we will hear, let's say, from Ola and Anna, let's say, what's going on? How will it be? Okay, how are things? Please.
Thank you. Thank you. So, yeah, I think I will start, and I will try to give you a very, very quick history of the Gapminder within a minute or less, hopefully. So it will, of course, be a very specific one. So let's start here. Gapminder, you know, it's a nonprofit, an educational nonprofit, working for a fact-based worldview everyone can understand. Pretty bold, but someone has to be that as well. And everything for us started actually here. In 1998, Hans showed us this chart. And it's pretty fascinating to see all these countries colored and so on, but it needed some more work. So without really planning to working together, we started helping Hans making this more beautiful, and we did different variations, and we made it moving and stuff like that. And finally, looking at this chart quite early on, I realized that when we try to understand the world, seeing the statistics like this actually help us quite a lot to understand what the world is like. But for people like me who had never traveled, I thought it would be actually helpful to also include photos into this one. So I took my camera, went to my mother's home in Ludvika, in Dalarna, and started to do complete documentation on every little thing in their home, and especially this one when her husband was actually doing the cooking. Hans took this, showed it in Abu Dhabi at the conference with only women in the audience, and suddenly one woman stood up and started applauding, and then all of them were standing up because actually my mother's husband was doing the dishes. So it was pretty nice. But then the bubbles continued, and I went for an excursion with my school of photography to New York. And I had the chance to go to World Bank in Washington to do a brown bag lunch. I had to Google what that was before because I had no clue. I went there with a computer. I barely understood how to operate, and I could barely speak English. But I did a pretty lousy presentation, and afterwards I was invited to the boss of the department. So I came into her office, I tried to do the same once again, and she started crying and she hugged me, and I thought, this is the most embarrassing moment in my life, because she is so sad, I come here and humiliate myself this much. So she just tries to sort of make me survive. But actually what she did, she wanted to have the bubbles, because we had taken their bubbles from the World Development Indicators. We had bought the data, put it on a CD-ROM with moving bubbles in front of it, and she saw that she could put it on a CD and sell their data for more. And we said, no, we don't want that, because we want all data to come together, which she was a bit disappointed to hear. So we went on, we realized if we want to mix all data together somehow, it won't be possible to do that on the CEDA grant we have. So for some reason, we have to figure out someone who can actually scale this for us. So we started trying to get Google to steal the idea. So we did it in different ways. Finally, it worked, but they didn't steal it. They wanted us to come and work, and we did. So we started improving the search results for public data, and we did charting, and we did different kinds of charting. But we realized something while being there. Actually, the saddest thing of all was too few people actually searched for public data. That was the really sad one. Then that you only get snippets information when you search. You already have a questions and you search for that. So in that way, we cannot help people to get another worldview. So it wouldn't work. So we realized we have to go back to Gapminder. We have to reach out to students in schools. That's our only chance. So I started spending quite a lot of time in schools. Unfortunately, I learned a lot of depressing things there as well. One thing was they used outdated facts. Another thing is that the teachers had no idea that they didn't know the world. And the third, they were also missing a worldview that was decent and realistic. So.
Yes. So I take over here for a short moment. My name is Ola Rosling. I'm Hans's son. And my main challenge now will be to tell you how we can continue without the famous sword swallower, which I will try to prove will be possible, because I'm also a possibilist. Okay. So what did we do with this problem in the schools? Well, we want to solve this problem. Show you the ignorance test that Helena Nordenstedt showed you before. Hans also did this test at many public events, for example, the World Economic Forum, but not the real forum, the experts who are supposed to teach the next day to the rest of the forum. He tested them the day before. And as you can see, those experts who teach the decision makers of this planet score worse than chimpanzees on the question of the future demographic trend of children, which is the core fundament of future demography. Instead, they think the world population is just exploding, right? Okay, we also tested this in January, me and Anna, when we went to the Cape Town to where we co-hosted the UN World Data Forum, which was the first data forum. I will now show you a short video with Pali, who is the statistician general of South Africa, who was also hosting the forum. And then I will show you the results of those tests. Can we please have the video with Pali? And Hans is calling in my live presentation, reflecting on the measuring we did.
For you all, statisticians across the world, data scientists, technologists, administrators, politicians, to have come to South Africa to witness the very first United Nations World Data Forum. At that forum, we are also addressed by the eminent professor, Hans Rosling, who shortly after that passed on. He left a legacy of making statistics beautiful.
And really, thank you very much for that, Rax. You know, is getting it from South Africa, where Bali had been my mentor for more than a decade, was emotional for me. But what you bring up now, Ola, has been one of the main shocks that you caused me. And the way that Ola and Anna has forced me to continue to measure has been very educative. We'll come to to the conclusion there is no way we can communicate the SDGs if we don't measure the impact of our communication. Because today people don't know that already 85% of children in the world get the most important vaccine. They don't know that most women have contraceptives. To fulfill the noble goal of 1.1 in eliminating poverty, we have to start knowing the facts and then focus on the places where extreme poverty is.
So this is from January this year. It's only a few weeks ago. We were standing in Cape Town. We tested a very noble audience with very nice dresses, and they scored, unfortunately, like everyone else, pretty much like the experts at the World Economic Forum. And these are not nasty questions. It's the experts of the world who go to the World Data Forum in Cape Town. How can they be so wrong? This audience in this room, Helena, am I right? It was the highest score we have ever seen on two of these questions. 80%, we have never seen such a high score. So a big applause. The other experts, because my point here is that it's not a question about intelligence. And this is the trouble of our whole exercise, that people get very annoyed when we say they are wrong about the world, because they confuse it with some intelligence, claiming that they are not as smart as the chimpanzees. It has nothing to do with intelligence. Everybody who has a driving license knows they had to practice. They were not born with that skill. You have to practice a skill. The problem is that the experts on this level don't have an incentive to learn about the world. When Hans went to the business meetings, though, and the corporate meetings who Bo Ekman and others helped him to get involved in, the CEOs of the companies, they have incentives to know the world. They score better than chimpanzees. It's the only group except these who score better than chimpanzees on this earth, because you need to have incentives. So how do we create these incentives, and how do we make it possible to score better than chimpanzees? Now I'm going to speed up, because we have very short time left, okay? So basically, the fact questions we're looking at, we use them to indicate a dramatic worldview consisting of three mega misconceptions. It's pretty simple. Most people seem to believe that the world is divided in two, the rich and poor, the north and south, or whatever you call them, men and women. Okay? That is most often wrong. The majority used to be in the middle. The second misconception is the world is getting worse, you know? We're overwhelmed by negative news, and therefore we think the world is getting worse. Of course, there are terrible things, but many things are improving. And the third misconception is the world is just, population is just increasing, because the curve is going upwards. Now, how can we make regular teachers aware of their misconceptions and then equip them with tools, slideshows, exercises to practice this in regular schools across the world and make people get the fact-based worldview? That is the challenge. It's an extremely exciting challenge, and we're working together with the great team here at ICAR and other universities in the world to do this. And we invite all of you to go to our website and download the slideshows and use the tools to make this happen. And I'm going to announce a few things. We also have a great audience online watching this webcast, if the technicians, Per and his friends, made it happen. So there is a huge global audience. We have millions of users of the Gapminder tool already. So we're not alone in this room. Let me run through the first two ones with the bubble chart. And now I'm going online. This is online. You can see, is the world divided in two? Do you see two groups of countries? No. Okay, so we're done with that one. Let's do the next one. Is the world getting worse? Well, let's go back in history and see if it was better. Okay, life was shorter and economy was worse and they was poorer. Go back 200 years and there is no country in the world on the level where the countries are today. Okay, so the world got better. Okay, then we're done with the two first misconceptions, and that was pretty simple, right? The third one is a little bit more complex. This is a map. Can you please remember, memorize this map now, because it shows where everybody lives in the world. No, unfortunately, you cannot, because your brains are too small. I'm not saying you're not smart, but the human brain cannot handle this kind of information. It's beautiful, it's interesting, but if we simplify it, you can remember it, and that's what we're doing. So instead of the wrong simple picture of the world, we try to create a more correct simple picture. It has to be simple, otherwise it won't stick. So where do the 7 billion people live? Well, 1 billion in Americas, 1 billion in Europe, and 1 billion in Africa. And where do the other four live? What do you think? It's in Asia, of course. Anyone here has a cell phone? Do you remember your PIN code? So this is the PIN code of the world, 1114. Please remember it, okay? This one you can remember. All right? So now we've fixed a lot of the issues. So now the question is, when you look at the world population curve, it looks like it's increasing, right? So obviously it's just increasing. The problem is the just. Because if we look at the future of the children in the world, it's flat already. Because the number of children per woman has decreased across the world, but people don't know about it. The challenge is to explain how the number of adults will increase. I'm doing that in a short moment. First, let's look at the babies across the world. This is the most revolutionary chart. Hans loved to show it. This happened during his lifetime. The children per woman went from 1965, 5 children per woman, and it dropped like it has never dropped before, ever, ever, ever in world history. This is the most revolutionary thing that could happen with modernization, education, contraceptives, and especially a modern family status. The idea of having a large family is no longer the popular thing across the world. Instead, you want to have a small family with very successful children who go to school. And this change of human culture has happened across different regions. We can look at Europe, who came first down, then America came in the baby boom, and then we have Asia also dropping. You see, across the world, what is it that happens? Well, parents talk about sex, right? We can talk about sex and we can plan our sexuality so we have fewer children. And I have 3, others have 1, and that makes 2 per parent, more or less. Okay, in the future, Africa is already on its dip down, you see? So we wait a few years. Of course, we have to continue the important family planning programs. But compared to what many environmentalists think, we need to do something drastic, you know, because the curve is going up. No. The drastic thing has already happened. Yes, let it continue now everywhere, right? This is a very important message. And now this, let me show you now how we can replace the sword swallower. One might think that it's impossible to replace Hans, right? He had so many skills in his personality. How can we replace him? I think everybody in this room jointly, we have enough skills to replace him, or even more, I would say. So if you don't have toilet rolls, because you ran out of toilet paper, because you've been using it so much, you don't have to do this with toilet papers, because you can also use PowerPoint instead of toilet paper. I will show you how to do that. 7 billion people now, you see the younger generations are 2 billion on each floor, and in the future, Hans used to say, sadly, the old will die. Yeah, he was right. And then the other generations are going to move up and become older, and they get their children. Now we're 8 billion people on this planet. But the number of children didn't increase, and the old people didn't get older. And we do that one more time like this. And with our slideshows and PowerPoint slides, who are freely available, and the tools, I think we can replace that sword swallower on stage, because you don't really have to be a performer. You tell these stories in a visual way, and people understand it. It's not that difficult. So we have put up all our slideshows on the downloads page. You click it, you download it, and you use it in your classroom. Please steal them. They are free of charge. And you can change them. You can put your name there, whatever. And every academic on this planet should do the same. Give away your slides. Spread knowledge. That's what we're doing, right? We also, yes. If you follow that link, the slides I'm using right now is also in one of the folders. Let's give away all the slides all the time. The tools, who were developed by tons of developers, it was not just me and Anna, but other people, are also freely available, and we're translating them now to multiple languages, completely free of charge, with the great support of many funders. You can download it and use it offline, and the new versions of Gapminder/tools are also useful on cell phones and small devices like this. And the source code is open source, so this one we will not sell to Google, okay? What does it give us? Well, it gives us a framework. We need to get the basic framework of the world right. Gapminder is not into the details. We just want you to see that there are different income levels and most people are in the middle, and that shows up in the difference of lifespan and education. Most people are on a middle level, and the huge change has already happened, and where are the people? This is a basic framework, and now, Anna, what else? Oh, please go ahead.
So, we have already sort of. I'm going to be as fast as I was last time again. So, being out in schools, we have seen, I've asked students, because I realize they don't really know the world. So I ask them, where do you think you belong? If you put the population from the poorest to the richest on a scale like this, where do Swedish students think that they belong? Most of them say that they are somewhere in the middle.
while in reality they are up here. So how the heck can they understand the world if they misunderstand it this much? So to deal with that, we can go to the statistics, to the yearbooks, but people hate statistics in this way, so that won't work, right? We can go to the media, but that won't work either, because we will only see the unusual events. So what we did was that we started another project, the Dollar Street Project. And now I know that I'm completely out of the time zone for this meeting, so I will be super fast. Simple idea, think of the world as a street. The poorest lives to the left, the richest to the right, and everybody else somewhere in between. We sent photographers to homes all over the world to see how people eat, what kind of toilets they have, and what beds they have, and 135 things more, and some videos on top of that. Just to show you briefly how you can use it, so what we do then, you remember the Swedish students said that they were in the middle. This is the tool itself, live. You can use it and you can collaborate with us on it. Here's the street that you see, the poorest to the richest. We can slide it like this to the middle, so we focus just on the families in the middle income spectrum. We change from families to, for instance, beds, because most people in Sweden have beds. And then we look at them and I ask the Swedish students, is this what your bedroom looks like? And they get a little bit uncomfortable. So we slide it upwards gradually, and then we can see that their bedrooms are more to the top. Here they start to recognize their own bedrooms. Here we see bedrooms in Mexico, France, Sweden, South Korea, Latvia, China, and so forth. And to find bedrooms like their own, they have to be in the richest part of the world. And we can do filtering, changing different things to look at, different geographies and so on. And we can go and browse the world visually by doing that. So, if we look at a quick example, should we just...
Hoppa.
Yeah. So we look here, this is US, two families in US. One of the richer, one of the poorer. We can look at their cutlery drawers and see the difference if you're in different income spectrums. And we can do the same with how the houses are organized in living rooms and so on. We can do it in China, three different families on different income levels. Here are their houses, their sofas, their stoves. Quite different, because very often we think of a country as this is how people do it in China. But if you look at the different incomes, you will see that that is not the case. Cool thing is when we start comparing across. So here, we look at the richest in US and the richest in China, and we can see similar bedrooms, and the place structures are identical, because they are made in China, of course. And then we can go to the poorest end, and we can compare a family in Nigeria and a family in China. They look very different. You wouldn't think that they have so much in common, but when we start looking at what they have in their home, same roof, same sofa, same grains, same dinner, and same way of cooking water. So if we would go here and take a picture in any of these kitchens, we would say that we know something about the culture in Nigeria, for instance. But when we look at the same income level, it will look the same all over the world. So by using photos as data, as we do in Dollar Street, the country stereotypes can actually fall apart. So what we would like to do with Dollar Street is, of course, doing more things. We want to do classrooms, churches, markets, and so on, and we need more homes. So for all of you who go out there, please contact us and help us and add more homes. Thank you. And now Ola, sorry.
Yes.
Sorry.
So I'm going to be extremely brief now and try to summarize it.
You see, we have some genetics in play here. So I'm poor sorry. Hans Wigzell. I'm sorry.
I'm telling you, let's say there are different watches.
Yes, there is no watch.
We use the homage to Hans Rosling watch.
Oh, can I speed up? So just to summarize this presentation, I will jump to my last slides. I skip all the factfulness slides and tell you basically, Gapminder is providing the fact-based worldview as a framework, but that's not enough. You also have to practice the skills of thinking critically about what you see in media, and controlling the dramatic instincts is what we call factfulness, which is more of a critical thinking ability. And today we announced on our website the Gapminder test, which we strongly recommend organizations like UD, Foreign Ministry of Sweden, and SIDA and others to use, so that you make sure that your employees are not less knowledgeable than chimpanzees, because I don't think you want that kind of employees. You can use the Gapminder test if you want people to know the facts. And actually, we decided to give this kind of certificate to anyone who passes it. And today we announced that Hans was the first Gapminder to pass this test. We know he could have tested it because he developed the questions together with us. And we all invite you to become Gapminders, to pass this test and then spread a fact-based worldview around the world. Kom upp på scenen så snabbt ni kan, okay? And now, Hans's grandchildren and me, I want to show you one last trick to show that you don't have to be a sword swallower. Take the shortcut up on stage, basically. I know this is overtime, but it's also very important.
Show how fast you are.
That if you cannot swallow swords, like in our family, the washing machine has enabled us to play a lot of bandy, which is a Swedish sport similar to ice hockey, but you don't hurt each other. This is Ted, and here is Ebba. Oh, Ebba forgot her helmet. So Ted, we can show you just a little bit of trick for anyone who cannot swallow a sword. Are you ready? Okay. Thank you. Oh, we got a winner. Thank you very much.
Yeah, bra, Ebba.
Kom, vi smyger undan.
Vi kan gå här. Nej, vi ska gå andra hållet, va?
Tack ska ni ha!
Kom, vi går här. Här går vi.
I think you have got the sense of my hopeless task of keeping time, right? And you also felt, let's say, that you understand that there is some funny thing with regard to an enormous energy levels, not only linked to the Rosling family as such, but even to the daughter-in-law sort of thing, right? It's an interesting one. Okay, we should have been finished, but we have a little bit more, okay? So Hans was an extreme mentor. Also, he had a big heart. He was sort of taking, let's say, it care of, let's say, the killed Swedish soldiers in Afghanistan, their families, things like that. It was actually quite remarkable. Abela Agnarsson came here. Please come up. Came here when she was 10 years old from Tanzania. Her parents have died from AIDS, and she had an aunt here, and she then moved up. In the society. She wrote to Hans in 2006 about could he do some research, and tell me what happened. You are now, let's say, I know, a director at Johnson & Johnson here in Sweden. Okay, yes. So please.
So good evening, ladies and gentlemen, my colleagues, my KI family sitting over there. And I also like to thank the member of the family for Hans. Sorry. So, can I take?
Sure. Sure.
Okay.
Sure.
I'll probably be crying through all this.
It's good. It's good. You cry.
So today, I dressed bright because, for me, it is a celebration of joy that Hans brought into our lives. Because friends once told me that God plays certain people in your life at certain times to guide you. And sometimes you don't need it. At least you don't understand that you need it. so just bump into them. So when I first time met Hans, let's say that we had our agreements and disagreements from day one. And don't try to outwit Hans, because they always have a comeback for everyone and for everybody, everything. So I had written to Hans about doing my PhD, or the possibility of doing a PhD at KI, at his department. And Hans responded immediately. So 3 weeks later, I was invited to a seminar department. Of course, upon I met Hans. So he started talking about the conzo, the disease that he had connected to eating bitter cassava during the dry season. And because I was young and stupid, so I told this professor, what is so special about your research? Everyone knows not to eat cassava during the dry season. And on the top of that, it is a shame and poverty disease. We don't talk about it. So the seminar started, and the issue was hanging. I was left hanging. So on my way out from the department, ICA, you know, you always passed Hans' office. So I passed Hans' office, and he invited me for a talk to continue the discussion. So that initial blunt conversation we had was the start of a mentorship that was stretched over a decade. And during those decades, we had many moments. And one of the moments that I remember was I was about to start my research in HIV. I wanted to understand how people took the HIV medication, but also to understand why some sites or locations were hit by HIV, but others did not. I had prepared for months, and I was about to bring my family with me in the field, so my family was ready to go, and I was about to get the last advice from Hans. So Hans came rushing into my office with these tons of documents and notes from his own research, Conzo, of course. And on top of that, he brought me a GPS device, which from I think was from the 90s, didn't work, but it was big as a brick. And he told me, take this GPS with you, document every place you can record people having sex. Document when, where, and with whom. And I should tell you, sexual risk behavior was one of our themes for a long time, me and Hans. I actually took that device with me, but I couldn't use it. But it gave me comfort in the field. But that conversation also laid up a ground or foundation or key for me on how to collect anthropological studies, which I did eventually. So for me, Hans gave me tangible guidance, not words. He gave me something that I could build a foundation every time. And this kind of cherished craziness that we had have launched me a professional and a personal odyssey was and is yet to come. And people have asked me, why do you have this mentorship for so long? And I always tell them, Hans had an open door, an open calendar mentorship style. And that simplicity and directness, it's sharing his time, experience, that is what I came to call the intelligence of simplicity, which created this trust I had for Hans. I enjoyed talking with him. I told him everything, my mistake, my success, my challenges. I told him everything, he listened, and I respected his guidance, even though I did not follow what he said that I was supposed to do, because that is a part of agreement. And when you needed him, he became that angel we all wish for. Some 10 years ago, my family, who were actually of Rwandese origin, were being expelled from Tanzania. They came to Tanzania during the 50s. And the Tanzania government, the president, had decided that everybody who were of Rwandese origin could not show a valid passport or valid visa would leave Tanzania. So I kept that secret for long and tried to find out how I could help my family, and of course the entire village actually are from Rwandese origin. But one day, when the mob knocked on our village, I had to act. So I knocked on the office of Hans. And little did I know that in that office, actually, Mr. Raleigh Bryant, a Google top official, was negotiating with Hans about buying the bubbles. And what happened that afternoon, to my surprise, Hans dropped everything. He got Rory Bryant to assist him in this. He contacted the Swedish church. You always say, whenever you want to need help, contact churches. So he contacted the Swedish church, the Catholic church. He contacted the Swedish government, all governments that they could approach. He contacted them. He also contacted the media, the BBC, the CNN, but as well the UN for that shaming order. And the following afternoon, the Tanzania president dropped that executive order immediately. And up to the day, we have five cows in my village with Hans Rosling's name on it. So in December last year, Hans and I celebrated 10 years together in mentorship. He came the whole way from Uppsala. And despite that, I knew he was ill. He was not well. But we had to celebrate. So we sat in my office at J&J. I had cookies, brownies, and a cup of chocolate. And Hans enjoyed it because he told me, I'm 12 years old now. I can do whatever I want. And above all, I need to gain weight, so I eat cookies whenever I want. But the most important thing, what happened there, is that we sat and talked. We talked about our lives. We talked about what we wish for our families, what we wish for me, and what I wish for him. But he also told me, Abela, you're like an orchid in the desert. You are doing well and will do well without me. And this was the last time I physically saw Hans. So, so to Hans, I would like to say, and that is something I want to say, that December day, when he gave me this big hug, that lasting hug, I would like to say, thank you for seeing me. And thank you for seeing all of us, all the world here in our own characters, because that is what he did. He saw us in our own characters. And thank you for being you, because you are who you are. And you will always be my compass in life. Thank you.
We are, thank you, Abela. We are soon coming to an end, but we have one more thing. Hans became a mentor for a lot of people, a big variety, and Bill and Melinda Gates were indeed mentored by Hans. And they both become honorary doctors at Karolinska, and, as well as personal friends to Hans and Agneta. And they made the following personal video for this particular, for this specific occasion, please.
Well, Hans had an authenticity, partly because his work started in the field.
He made global health and development accessible to everybody. With his humor, his characteristic style, and his command of the numbers, he made you sit up and pay attention. And I think he will always be known for being an amazing teacher of global health.
Well, there's really no one who did a better job of taking the wonderful progress that's been made and making it understandable, comparing it to previous generations of health, looking at those bubbles, working with his son to make sure the visualization was really, really engaging, along with his personality. He clearly cared so much. He wanted people to know. He wanted the world to do more. And even for us, it was inspirational.
He talks so much about the numbers, but for him, behind all those big numbers he was teaching about, there was always the human story and the human connection. And he always, in private, made that human connection as well. And it's one of the things I most admire about him.
Yeah, and I always wondered how he got to be such a good speaker, because he was phenomenal. And it wasn't just the sword swallowing, although that helped a lot.
Yeah, later it had props, right? It had a big pointer, and then there were boxes, and then there were little figurines. He was always evolving his talks, and that was always fun to see where he was going next.
Hans always had this positive attitude. Even as he had health challenges, he was always so upbeat. He was a real inspiration, one of few people who really kept us going full speed. And I know he did that for others as well.
My father often says to us that the biggest gift a father can give his children is to love their mother. And Hans absolutely loved Agneta. We want you all to know, Agneta and Hans's family, that you were deeply loved. He was just a tremendous gift to the world, and we're so thankful that you shared him with us, his many friends.
Yeah, it's so great that he had your backing to travel the world and, you know, help in how the data got presented. It's something to be very, very proud of. What an incredible legacy.
I'll end with some personal views about what I think. What did Hans think of himself? He was never satisfied. There was too much to be done. He was not an optimist, he was a realist. And I was struck by, let's say, that suddenly something may happen. Some time ago, Magnus, their youngest son, got a surprising phone call out of pocket from Hans driving a car. You know, the phone call is phone is ringing, and so Magnus was listening and wondered, what is this all about? And it was his father, Hans, singing with full voice, a rare thing in the family, indeed. Singing a text that he knew by heart, seemingly, singing a duet. In fact, actually, he was singing a duet by Frank Sinatra. So I think he was a proud man. So please imagine Hans Rosling now, in the morning in the car, driving from Uppsala to Stockholm, happily singing a duet with Frank Sinatra. And I believe it's a proud man that is singing.
And now the end is near.
Imagine Hans singing this.
And so I face.
He knew all the text.
The final curtain. My friend, I'll say it clear. I'll state my case. Of which I'm certain, I've lived a life that's full. I traveled each and every highway and more, much more than this. I did it my way. Regrets I've had a few, but then again, too few to mention. I did what I had to do, and saw it through without exemption. I planned each charted course, each careful step along the byway, and more, much more than this, I did it my way. Yes, there were times.
Leaners,
I'm sure,
put on the mic. The family would like to thank the audience.
You have me here? My name is Anna. I'm the other Anna who you do not want to book for your talks. I do pretty good talks, but not on this.
And I'm Magnus, I'm the youngest son.
We would like to thank all of you on the behalf of our mother and our families.
And we first of all would like to thank Hans for the fantastic support he has given us and Hans and the family over this last year during Hans' illness. It's very important. We find each other at work, but we become friends, and I think that's an important message. The other thing is we would like to thank all the fantastic contributions and the wonderful words, all the flowers that have come to us. It's a fantastic support in this sad time. And the fund at UNICEF, it's just beautiful to see how it's growing. And I've read all the messages in the board, and it's beautiful and it's heartwarming. Thank you very much.
And furthermore, we would like to thank you all for believing and seeing the need to spread a fact-based worldview. This to teach everybody is hard. It may seem impossible, but we all know that the seemingly impossible will always be possible. And finally, on behalf of the family, we thank you all for the work that you have ahead of you. We thank you for the future. We thank you for the absolute eradication of extreme poverty. This is what we have in front of us. This is what Hans most of all cared about. And this is on his behalf. I thank you all for your future work.
Well, this memorial service has come to an end, but I would like all of us to give an enormous applause to Hans Rosling. Thank you. Thank you all. Thank you all for coming.